Is analogia. Let me offer two transitional statements from our series on Trinitarian anthropology. Now, first, having established that the human being is made in the image of the Trinity, particularly in its godlike functioning, we now need to move into a further discussion of the image of the Trinity and its likeness, its analogia to God. We follow Bonhoeffer in using analogia rather than the Vulgate's synonymous similitudinem. Alongside this, we must consider the existence of the image in this world, the world sub sola, under heaven or under the sun. There are two further truths that I want to emphasize in the discussion of foundational anthropology. We will consider the first in this second De Higginbotham lecture and the next one in the third lecture. Our created lives as male and female have bound our human identity to one another in reflection of God the Trinity's eternal life, as inextricably intertwined in three persons. Human genders reflect both Trinitarian perichoresis and Trinitarian taxis. I'll give more definition to that. Our created lives as embodied souls, secondly, the place for the triune image, are lives that keep our feet on earth and our hearts in heaven. There are two questions that face all human beings. The first is who am I? Now, this is the question of individual human persons. And the second is, who are we? And this is the question of communal human persons, the same persons, but asked together. Both questions must be answered from a biblical perspective. Now, Scripture often offers, by the way, a different set of answers than human cultures. Too often, Christians have allowed cultures to set the agenda rather than Scripture. And take, for instance, the hyper-individualism and the self-deification of the modern West. There are two biblical texts before us that help provide answers to these two existential human questions. Who are we and who am I? The first text is considered here tonight. The second text will be considered tomorrow. The first text is in Genesis chapter 2, and it is the second song recorded in Scripture. And it helps answer the communal human question. Tomorrow, the sublime description in Ecclesiastes 3 helps answer the individual human question. Well, let us consider the second song, Genesis chapter 2 and verse 23. The first song, you will remember, and its surrounding text correlated man with God through demonstrating the function of man in relation to the proper works of the Trinity. Man was given rule, reflecting the Father's rule. Man was also given logic and language, reflecting the Son of God as Word. And thirdly, man was given life, reflecting the Holy Spirit as giver of life. The second song, however, brings into sharper focus the structure of man in his relation to the being of God. The divine persons are distinct and hierarchical, expressed well in the Greek term taxis. Even as the divine persons are intertwined and unified, expressed well in the Greek term perichoresis. Taxis and perichoresis, order and equality, are as true for the Trinitarian image as they are for the Trinity. The second song in Scripture is authored by the first man, and it is focused upon the first woman. Where the first song brought creation to a crescendo of ultimate beauty, the second song brings the naming of creation to a crescendo of reflection upon human beauty. Where the first song is composed of four poetic lines, the second song is not as complete, being composed of only two poetic lines. Man's song reflects God's song, but without God's fullness, subtly indicating the limit of human analogy to reflect divine reality. Where the first song concerned God pouring himself into his exalted creature, the second song concerns man reflecting upon the relation of himself to his corresponding creature, the woman. There are three notes in Adam's song. And these can be described in two ways, these three notes. A historical way to describe the three major notes in this second song is that it teaches, one, that man receives this woman, two, that man recognizes her correspondence, and three, that man recounts her identity. But a theological way to describe these notes is that they teach, one, the grace of woman, two, the relationality of humanity, and three, the ordering of humanity. We will consider the historical way, but we're going to focus on the theological way. The grace of woman, the relationality of humanity, and the ordering of humanity. Now, first of all, the grace of woman. Let me read to you Genesis 2 and verse 23. This is after God has brought the woman to the man. And the man said, "This one at last is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. Now, this one will be called woman, for she was taken from man." The first note in Adam's song is that man receives this woman. Woman is a grace, a divine grace to man. The operative expression for grace in the second song is Adam's ecstatic response, hapa'am, now, or you may see it translated, at last. The same expression is found in Genesis 30 and verse 20, where Leah cries out, "God has now endowed me with a good gift." Let us look more carefully at the grace of woman that comes to man from God. There are five ways that this passage indicates that woman is a grace. Woman is a grace in blessing, a grace of identity, a necessary grace for man, a predestined grace, and a created grace. Note that the divine gift to man of woman is later described as both a blessing and an identity. As Genesis 5, verses 1 through 2 demonstrate, this remains true after the fall, and I quote, "On the day God created man, he made him in the likeness of God. He created them male and female. When they were created, he blessed them and called them mankind." So first of all, the first grace is blessing. In spite of the cynical and inappropriate jokes to the contrary, and you have heard them or said them yourselves, woman is not given to be an external curse to the man's self-absorbed flesh. Rather, she is a divine blessing. Woman is given to man to be a blessing in the bonding of man and woman into one flesh. Martin Luther saw the gift of woman as a blessing in numerous ways. She is a blessing to bring companionship to man. I myself have discovered that I am in dire need of companionship, so much so that it makes me cling to the woman God has given me. Martin Luther also said that the woman is a blessing because she brings protection against post-fall sin, post-lapsarian sin. And moreover, she brings with her procreation, the gift of children. And children are indeed gifts of God, not burdens, gifts. The second grace of woman is identity. Female and male receive a dual identity by grace. Now hear this, because I think this will help you to see where some of the contemporary problems in our culture can be addressed and addressed in a biblical manner. On the one hand, the female, Nekeba, is created alongside the male, Zakar. receiving the image and likeness of God together with the male. And this is repeated, Genesis 1:27 and 5:2, male and female together receive the image. The gender of each is a form of identity given distinctly to each. The gifts of maleness and femaleness are not in the power of humanity. They are given. These are given in the gift of God. They are not in the purview of man. Contemporary claims that one may change one's gender identity is rooted in an idolatry of self. It is a direct contradiction of the grace of gendered identity. God gave you your maleness and God gave you your femaleness, and you cannot give yourself the opposite or something else entirely. This is divine grace. On the other hand, the woman and the man are together identified by God as mankind, Adam. While the difference of gender creates distinct identities for male and female, the sharing of human nature creates a common identity. So, borrowing from Christology, we might say the male is fully human and fully male, while the female is fully human and fully female. Both in Adam and in gender, you have a gift of God. It is what unites us. It is also what makes us different. And this is grace, not something that is a human work. The third grace is the fact that it is necessary. Another indication that woman is a grace is found in Genesis 2:18. Apart from woman, man is in a context that is lo tob, not good. Or we could even translate it, not beautiful. Do you understand that, guys? Man is ugly without woman. Amen? For the man, God's exalted creature, to be alone is to be less than what God intends. Now, I want to set aside issues of singleness. We are looking at the first man. Rather, companionship between man and woman is God's created intention. Man, this man, Adam, apart from woman, lacks this grace, a grace that itself reflects God. For man and woman together have creative potential alongside the Creator. It is through procreation that the creature reflects the Creator. And this particular imaging of God requires both the man and the woman. It is impossible to have procreation without something from the man and something from the woman. I will let your biology teachers fill that in. The fourth grace of woman is that it is a predestined grace. Woman is God's created grace for man, and this grace also reflects inner Trinitarian self-reflection. Where in the first song God had said, "Let us make," now before the second song, God says, "I will make." The plural self-reference of the eternal God in chapter 1, verse 26, now becomes a singular self-reference in chapter 2 and verse 18, indicating yet again the concurrent complexity and simplicity of God. Woman is a grace. A predestined grace for man, a grace that has poured forth from the eternal counsel. Woman is a grace that is intended to keep man from being not good, from being ugly. Woman is not a hurried afterthought of God concerning his original creation's deficiency. Woman, rather, is a foreordained forethought of God concerning his creature's wholeness. Woman is a predestined grace. Finally, among the graces, woman is a created grace. She is brought to man out of man's entire lack of cognitive activity. Her creation was not in man's mind, nor in man's power. Genesis 2, 21 through 22. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to come over the man, and he slept. Some of God's best gifts are given while we are asleep. God took one of the ribs and closed the flesh at that place. Then the Lord God made the rib he had taken from the man into a woman and brought her to the man. There is nothing in man that can bring woman to pass. He is the entirely passive recipient of a gracious movement that only the triune creator can plan, speak, and implement. She is a created grace of God. Luther believes that when God brought her to the man, this was the first act of betrothal. This man and this woman are now husband and wife in the sight of God and of man. The verb for creation in this text, by the way, is not bara, which indicates creation out of nothing, as in Genesis 1:1 and 1:27. Neither is it asa, which means to make, which you find in Genesis 1:26. Nor is it yatsar, which means to form or to fashion, which is found in Genesis 2, verse 7. The verb in Genesis 2:22 is bana, which means to build. Yes, she is built. The creation of humanity involves creatio ex nihilo with regard to the image, bara, but creation out of existing physical matter with regard to the bodies of both man and woman. And the woman's body is created from the man's body. Still, we have here a creative act of God. Just as the man does not emerge until a creative divine act on the dust takes place, so the woman does not emerge until a creative divine act is performed on the man's side. In a diffuse refraction of the eternal origin of the divine persons, we note these similarities. Woman proceeds from the body of man. And man is generated from the body of man through the body of woman. But man is not the self-originating cause of himself nor of the woman. Humanity, male and female, is a created grace in a threefold way. Number one, humanity is a grace that God created for community with God's self through the gift of his own image and likeness. We are created today through woman for community with God. Number two, humanity is a grace of male and female to each other. The fundamental institution of the family is a gift of God. And number three, humanity is a grace to the earth and is meant to rule the earth for God by serving and guarding the earth, Genesis 2, 5 and 15. So the first note is that woman is a grace. Let's look at the second note, which concerns the relationality of humanity. The second note in this second song is that man recognizes the correspondence of woman and he names her relation to himself. Adam had been taken by God to survey the animals, and it was noticeable that while the animals had suitable partners, the human being did not. You can see this in verse 20. But even before this became evident in time, God had predetermined in his eternal counsel that man required a suitable partner. The specific language of the divine plan is important. I will make a helper as his complement. I will make a helper as his complement. Genesis 2:18. The two terms here, helper and complement, that God uses to describe his plan for man and woman, in the Hebrew ezer and kenegdo, indicate both order and equality, both dependence and contribution, both identity and relationality. First of all, ezer. Ezer means one who gives aid or simply helper. It does not imply inferiority in quality. Indeed, the term helper is often used of God in relation to Israel and often appears in a threefold couplet. If you would, you can check these on your own, but look at Deuteronomy 33, verses 7, 26, and 29. God is a helper three times in that chapter. And also look at Psalm 33, 20, where God is a helper once. And then Psalm 115, verses 9 through 11, which gives you a liturgy that thrice describes God as Israel's helper. The verb form adzar is used to mean succor or save from danger or deliver from death. So the ezer, the helper, does not indicate ontological inferiority, but it functionally indicates a movement toward the other. A helper is one who is moving toward the other. Kenegdo, the second term, is a derivative of neged, which means before, against, or in the presence. Hamilton translates it literally as, I will make for him a helper as in front of him or according to what is in front of him. Exegetically, it suggests that what God creates for Adam will correspond to him. Thus, the new creation will be neither a superior nor an inferior, but an equal, yet different. Martin Luther translates the Hebrew kenegdo as that which should be about him. This means that marriage is an inseparable relationship. I think we have lost this in contemporary culture, where we are constantly engaged in multiple and diffuse specialization, such that the woman and the man are often forgetting that they are intended to be inseparable. Unlike animals who copulate and relocate, human beings are intended for continual presence. Luther says, there the wife so binds herself to a man that she will be about him and will live together with him as one flesh. Dietrich Bonhoeffer translates kenegdo more simply as partner. The woman is a partner of the man in bearing the limit imposed upon him. She is the other who stands beside me and constitutes a limit for me. I think, by the way, when I read this, of my own wife. She is not a limit to me in a negative way, but in a very positive way, for she is a piece of me. She is the limit that I love and that I will not transgress because of my love. If ezer indicates a sense of order and movement from one toward the other, a helper, kenegdo indicates a sense of equality between the one and the other. To borrow the Greek Trinitarian terms, we may say that humanity, like God, demonstrates both taxis, differentiated order, and perichoresis, unified mutuality. These two relational terms bring to mind the enlightening philosophical ruminations about the I-thou relation that Martin Buber defined, and I refer you to his work. They also bring to mind the philosophical, theological reflections upon face-to-face and personhood that Roger Scruton so eloquently put forward. And thirdly, they bring to mind the theological definition of personhood as being in communion that John Zizioulas made famous. And I encourage you to engage with all three of those writers. However, For the purpose of these lectures, in their focus upon the image of the Trinity, let me point you to the fruitful theological ruminations of the 20th century Christian martyr, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, a Lutheran. Many theologians have resorted to the work of Karl Barth and Emil Brunner for the origin of recent ideas about the image of God being located in the male and female relationship. However, it was Bonhoeffer who first made the connection. As I have elsewhere indicated, this is easily discerned through an examination of the publications of the three. Bonhoeffer identified the image of God as Trinity in Genesis 1, 26 through 27, directly with the male-female relation, arguing it is the correct analogy for the image. He then continued that discussion in his commentary on Genesis 2, verses 18 through 25. Drawing upon the divine attribute of freedom, Bonhoeffer demonstrates how the human creature is both like and unlike God. An analogy says that there is something both like and unlike. The human creature is free in that one creature exists in relation to another creature, in that one human being is free for another human being. And God created the man and woman. The human being is not alone. Human beings exist in duality. And it is in this dependence on the other that their creatureliness consists. Against the standing ideas of the structure of humanity in individualist ontology, Bonhoeffer revolts. He says the likeness, the analogia of humankind to God is not analogia entis, analogy of being, but analogia relationis, analogy of relation. What analogia relationis means to Bonhoeffer is first and foremost not the relationship of man to woman, but the relationship of man and woman to God. The man and woman relation is analogous to the internal relations of God. This analogia must not be understood as though humankind somehow had this likeness in its possession or at its disposal. Instead, the analogia or likeness must be understood very strictly in the sense that what is like derives its likeness only from the prototype itself and is like it only in pointing to it in this way. The likeness of God that is humanity in man and woman must refer to God for its meaning. You don't look to man to understand God. You look to God to understand man. In a no less theological way, though without thousands of years of the academy behind him, pre-fallen Adam expresses agreement with Dietrich. But Adam is much more poetic than the academic Dietrich, though Dietrich also tried his hand at poetry, as we shall see. The first verse of Adam's spontaneous song of praise to God is, "This one is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh." Adam is definitely expressing pleasure at the fact that this one is unlike the animals God brought before him, whose nature he discerned and whose names he ascribed. Rather, this one, this woman, is of the same nature as he is. She corresponds to him. If basar, Hebrew flesh, conveys the idea of weakness, frailty, and perishableness, then etzem, the Hebrew word for bone, may convey the idea of power, strength, and potential permanence. In comparison to the animals, prelapsarian woman has the same strengths and weaknesses as prelapsarian man. Let us continue with the third note, the ordering of humanity. The third note in Adam's song regards the naming of the woman, the ordering of humanity. Let us rehearse the prelapsarian context. Before moving into a discussion of the last verse in Adam's song, we must consider the context in which it was given. This is important to make explicit because many objections about the ordering of humanity arise as a result of the fall. I dare say that if we were still in the garden and the fall had not occurred, we would not have existential anxiety about questions on human tyranny, dysfunctional patriarchy, radical feminism, perverse gender inclinations, perverse sexual inclinations, and so on. The context requires that we put forward a short theology of power or kingship. And secondly, a review of the goodness of prelapsarian life. Let me offer a short theology of the origin, rebellion, and judgment of power. First of all, origin. One of the most important aspects of creation is that all power derives from the hand of God. God originally gave powers and responsibilities to angelic, human, and natural entities. God is king. He is the source of all power. But then there is rebellion. As a result of the fall of humanity into sin through the temptation of the serpent, creation itself was subjected to futility. Angelic and human powers are in rebellion, and natural powers are in futile subjection. The kingdom of God is under assault from the kingdom of this world, which is now ruled by the usurper, the devil. And yes, this theologian believes that Satan is a real and active being. We are at war. And we must stop laughing about the war. Judgment is the third. God, therefore, sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to conquer the powers of sin in a mysterious way. He died on the cross to reconcile human rebels. Christ has been given all power, and he is setting the powers in their proper place. At his second coming, he will usher in the judgments of individuals, of nations, and he will then return properly ordered and subjected powers to the Father. This is a short theology of power. When we speak of order, it must be understood that the original order was without dysfunction. Adam's disobedience brought the internal struggle of man against man and the external struggles with both demonic and natural powers. And you can read about these struggles in Genesis chapter 3, where the woman will be desiring, striving against the man, but the man will rule her. But the descriptions of life in Genesis 1 through 2 precede the fall in Genesis 3. Because of the rebellion against divine power, power relationships are now filled with problems. Problems that are intractable apart from the coming of the kingdom of God, from divine intervention. There are a few things also that we need to see about the goodness and beauty of the original prelapsarian creation order in which man dwelt. These include communion, life, righteousness, love, holiness, and freedom. I want you to consider these because when you consider how order was understood before the fall, then the problems that we have with male and female complementarianism and the created order will fade away. First of all, communion and life. Note that it was characterized by communion between God and humanity. God brought the animals to man. He brought the woman to man. He walked with man in the cool of the day. God spoke directly with humanity and considered his creation very good. Communion with the living God, of course, also demonstrates that life itself is part of the goodness in which man dwelt. Death was only contained in a word of warning. Life's fruit was free. Righteousness. The Augustinian tradition referred to this as original righteousness. Life was granted to man and seems to have been available perpetually to man if he had not sinned. The command and the warning indicate that eternal life was available. Love. We have already noted that when God brought the woman to Adam, he reacted with pure joy. According to Luther, Adam's cry of "at last" expresses most beautifully the affection of a husband who feels his need for a delightful and full relationship or cohabitation in both love and holiness. It indicates an overwhelming, passionate love. I can still remember when my bride came down that aisle and the joy that filled my heart. It was almost unbelievable. And I'm often reminded of that love. Holiness and freedom. The fact that God warned against sin indicates that while God gave so much blessing to humanity, there is also limit. Humanity's freedom to exercise its powers is intended to operate within limits or according to God's sacred purposes. The warning against the participation in the fruit of one tree is preceded by the freedom to participate in everything else. You are free to eat, God says, but you must not. The right to eat widely demonstrates the great freedom that God gave to man. The limit to eat demonstrates the holiness that God demands of man. The explicit ordering of humanity is also, as we have seen, in the ascription of Ezer to the woman. Woman is given by God to man in order to help him fulfill the vocation to which God has committed him. Man is to rule the creation for God. He is to serve and protect God's earth. Humanity is empowered to do this freely through righteous communion with this holy God from the motivation of love. The ordering of humanity that has man providing the lead to woman and woman helping man fulfill God's command for God's glory, that is the pristine order. This helps make sense, then, of what Adam does next. Adam exercises a power over woman that woman does not exercise over man. The man names the woman. Earlier, man was given the logic to discern the nature of animals. He was also given the language by God to name the animals. Naming is an act of power that assigns identity to a being. Naming indicated man's rule over the animals. And now man also names woman. Man exercises authority over the woman through naming her. And this exercise was carried out in communion with God in a holy, righteous, and loving manner. Authoritatively, yet with freedom pouring forth from God through the man into the woman. The first man's first exercise of authority over the first woman, his wife, was not done with tyranny, abuse, or neglect. Those will come later as a result of sin. But for now, before the introduction of sin, human authority is exercised in a divine way. The Trinitarian image reflects well the being and the character of the Trinity in ruling. Remember, Adam twice names his wife, once before the fall and after the fall. First, in the Song of chapter 2, Adam names her as one corresponding to him. This one will be called woman, for she was taken from man. Adam's Hebrew name for her is Isha, which means woman or wife, depending on the context. A woman is a wife to only one man, and then only in a covenant that begins with betrothal and ends with death. Let me say that again so that it is clear. A woman is a wife to only one man, and then only in a covenant that begins with betrothal and ends with death. Romans 7:2. Adam and this woman were in a marriage covenant from the moment the Lord gave her in betrothal until the moment one of them died. Note also that Isha, woman, is a derivative of Ish, which means man or husband, again depending upon covenantal context. Why did Adam choose this name and not another? I believe it is because he was inspired by God to discern and identify the woman in relation to himself as the man. She was his woman, his wife, and she is both different from him and one with him. She is different in gender, and the same in humanity. Building on this seminal event, the foundation of the family by God is given more description in the next two verses. Consider five things from the words of the narrator, Moses. First of all, the priority of the family. Note that the foundation of the family precedes the foundations of both the state and the church. The state does not begin until sin comes and evil requires restraint. Romans 13. The church does not begin until the coming of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. Acts 2. The divine structure of the family is simply not up to the state or the church to define or redefine. Rather, it is for the church to proclaim and the state to honor. Alas, churches too often fail in their task of proclaiming the family. And states too often seek to redefine the family, for example, through recognizing polygamy, divorce, or same-sex unions. The priority of the family. Secondly, in the ordering, notice that there are distinct families. The family has often been challenged precisely because we have failed to understand that the marriage bond begins with betrothal. According to Moses, this is why a man leaves his father and mother and bonds with his wife. Genesis 2:24. The marriage bond supersedes all other family bonds. There is no interference to be brooked between parents and children who are married. Formerly as a pastor and now as one who frequently provides premarital counseling alongside my wife, I can tell you that one of the major causes of marital trouble is the interference, bold or subtle, of mothers or fathers. For instance, I saw it in my own family and was compelled to warn my own mother that if she played games in my family, she would lose. That was a tough conversation, but necessary. A man leaves his father and mother and bonds with his wife. Also notice that there is a new being. If leaving parents breaks an old bond, cleaving or clinging, you leave and you cleave. Cleaving or clinging to a wife indicates the creation of a new bond, a covenant. The language here is really quite shocking in hyper-individualistic culture. The man, chapter 2, verse 24, part B, the man bonds with his wife and they become one flesh. The word flesh here is likely intended to indicate the earthly aspect of human life. The word echad means one, unique, or alone. While the man was not intended to be alone, the man was intended to be alone with his wife. They are no longer two, but one. What is being pinpointed is solidarity. The man by himself is not one flesh. The woman by herself is not one flesh. The two are one flesh. The two beings have become a new being with a singular identity. I think this truth is far beyond our ability to conceive in the modern West. And it is something that needs to be reclaimed. Fourthly, there is a pure relation. Chapter 2, verse 25. Both the man and his wife were naked, yet felt no shame. Of course, one of the greatest fears of every human being is to stand in front of a crowd naked, is it not? The utter purity of prelapsarian man in his communal being as husband and wife is on full display in this passage. The statement, again, is shocking, but in any human culture, for all human beings, except for those whose consciences have been seared by continual embrace of perversity, properly feel shame at their nakedness. Luther believed that in their prelapsarian state, human beings had their greatest glory in their nakedness, but the fall has changed nakedness into their greatest shame. Finally, with regard to the ordering of humanity, notice that it has continuing importance. It cannot be overstated that this description of the sacred ordering of the family continues to be important to humanity in general, and the people of God in particular. In the New Testament, elements of Genesis 2, 18 through 25 serve as major teaching points for both Jesus and Paul. Consider carefully the following passages and their impact upon the ordering of humanity. Matthew chapter 19, verse 5. Mark chapter 10, verses 7 through 8. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 16. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 2 through 16. Ephesians 5, 31, and 1 Timothy 2, 8 through 15. These, by the way, are the very texts that bring so much angst and heartache in our hyper-individualistic, self-idolizing time and place. These are the texts that evangelicals find themselves arguing over and over again. I commend to you Article 18 of the Baptist Faith and Message for their proper interpretation. An article, by the way, that Mrs. Dorothy Patterson and Dr. Paige Patterson had much to do with in being added to the Baptist Faith and Message. Even after the fall in chapter 3, Adam still continued to exercise his authority by giving his wife a proper name that could be confused with no other woman. Adam named his Eve because she was wife, or named her Eve because she was the mother of all the living. Genesis 3:20. The Hebrew chava, Eve, means literally life giver. Perhaps even in his fallen state, Adam was still capable of being inspired by the Lord. And redolent of the Spirit of God as life giver, the woman reflects this important work of the Spirit. While woman does not create life out of her own power, she is the avenue God has chosen to create new lives. This too is in likeness to God, the Trinity. The ordering of humanity in the triune likeness of God as equal and distinct did not cease with the fall of man. The image, therefore, seems to continue after the fall. Now, let us return to the issue of the analogies of relation and being in closure. Like his contemporary Karl Barth, Dietrich Bonhoeffer was scandalized by the idea of the analogia entis. Bonhoeffer replaced it with the analogia relationis. But Bonhoeffer modified his objection in a way that Barth may not have appreciated. Barth disliked the analogia entis because it indicated that the being of the world could be the means by which we may grasp God himself, which sounded like a form of Pelagian revelation to him. Barth even called it the invention of the Antichrist. Barth preferred instead the analogia fidei, by which he meant that the only way to grasp God is through the divine gift of faith in Jesus Christ. Bonhoeffer rightly agreed with Barth that the emphasis should be on the grace of faith in the God of Jesus. However, Bonhoeffer did allow for the marriage relation between man and woman to point back to the imminent divine relations. Barth himself would never formally countenance the analogies movement from creation to creator. While I would agree with many of Barth's objections, and while I would severely limit any lessons that the world can tell us about God to just really the existence of God and the expectation of his judgment, we also want to reverse the analogia entis and advocate its usefulness with regard to the Imago Trinitatis. Alongside Bonhoeffer, I would agree that there is an available correspondence between the relations within the Trinity and the relations within humanity. Yet I have focused not on what humanity can tell us about God, but on what the revelation of God about God can tell us about humanity. Against Bonhoeffer, I would argue that the being of God should also be able to tell us something about the being of man in creation, and in what he is intended to be in redemption, and something about him in the consummation. There is a place for the analogy of being as well as the analogy of relation, as long as we have a revelation regarding the being of God and what he expects of humanity. In practice, what this means is that through the analogy of relation, The relations of the Trinity in perichoresis, that is, in God's unified mutuality, and his taxis, that means in his orderly hierarchy, these shed light for us upon the proper relations of humanity, especially, but not only, regarding marriage. Similarly, through the analogy of being, the being of the Trinity is displayed through his attributes, or at least through those attributes that are intended to be communicated, we may learn something about the image of the Trinity in humanity. If God, the Trinity, is loving, holy, and righteous, and he demands such of man, so the image is to be loving, holy, and righteous. Let me conclude with a personal word about love, righteousness, and holiness. Among the churches today, there is much talk about love. You can see the left side of evangelicalism, such as in the teachings of the undiscerning Rob Bell, for this. There is, on the other side, much talk about justification or righteousness. You can see the teachings of the new Calvinism, for instance. For my part, I have also written about both love and righteousness. However, largely forsaken in contemporary evangelicalism is that divine, that triune attribute, which ought to be a human attribute, that triune attribute that John Wesley once emphasized. God is holy, and man is called to be holy. We need a revival of holiness in this day of bold and rank wickedness. Thank you.
Dr. Yarnell, thank you so much for that very rich and informative, thoughtful, and biblical lecture. We're so very grateful for your service to us this evening. Would you be open to taking a few questions from the audience?
Yes, sir.
All right. We have a few minutes for questions. If you would like to ask a question, if you would raise your hand, and I'll try to get to you so we can capture the question on microphone. For purposes of the recording that we're making tonight. Questions for Dr. Yarnell? Yes, just a moment.
Dr. Yarnell, Sean Wegener, I was a head note that you had written down that the limit not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was showing God's holiness. I was wondering, in light of the conclusion of your lecture, if you could expand on that thought.
That's a good question. And actually, that's an area that I want to do more in, because I think that that command, that original command, demonstrates both freedom and holiness together. By freedom, of course, you may. You may eat of these, all of these, so many. But there is a limit. There is something sacred. There is something that is set off, and this is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And God has decided to set this off, demonstrating its sacredness or its holiness. Holiness, of course, means separation or consecration. And so this tree has been consecrated. It has been separated out to God. And so, therefore, it is holy. And so holiness and freedom are always in communion with one another. Our difficulty is that we often use the idea of freedom to mean without limit. There is no such thing as freedom without limit. There is in the modern mythology of freedom, and it's a mythology that is available and widely seen in the politics of both left and right in the modern West. I mean, freedom is understood as I can do whatever I want. Well, no, freedom has never meant I can do whatever I want. There has always been a limit. There has always been holiness. God has always reserved something for himself that is not man's. And so holiness is that which is sacred or consecrated to God. And that's why I would argue that holiness and freedom are both evident in the garden.
Another question.
Dr. Yarnell, you talked about how our culture has really lost a lot of accepting different roles and distinctions. So as a word to pastors and ministers and churches, it's like especially in preaching and then also like with your children's ministry and youth ministry, what are some practical ways that you would like to see our churches learning about this and talking about this? So do you have any word to say it to that?
Did you say the word practical? I am a systematic theologian. We don't engage in practical, do we? I will say this. For pastors and teachers, when you get into conversations about roles, make sure that your definitions for the roles come from Scripture. And that they don't come from just your good idea. You may have a good idea, but be clear as to what is of divine revelation and what is of your own opinion. Because what you think will change tomorrow. God's word is permanent. It never changes. And so the roles and the distinctions that are defined by Scripture, and I gave you one of them, I think that the issue of naming, this authority that Adam had over Eve, I think that that demonstrates to us that there is an authority that man has over woman that cannot be done away with. Now, it needs to be exercised in holiness and righteousness and love, but yet it still stays there. If you were to ask me to get more practical, well, let's ask a question about, in a marriage, who takes care of the finances? I don't know that Scripture gives an exact answer to that, except that the man has the authority to make sure it gets done. But I know guys whose wives are CPAs. And knowing them personally, I wouldn't give them a $10 bill and expect them to operate with it correctly. And so if he is wise, then he will assign that responsibility to his helper. So I think there has to be a judicious understanding of context and a rock-hard going along with the Word of God. Do not compromise the roles and distinctions that Scripture makes. Our problem is that the devil wants us to continually compromise, and this is what ushers in all sorts of problems into our contemporary relationships. Dr. Bingham, there's one right here. Please remember to give us your name.
Oh, Dr. Yanao, there are many verses in the Bible that have the insults words about women, and like Ezekiel chapter 16, it's an analogy about a faithful Jerusalem, and there are many insults words about women, and some people even claim that if you want to find a teaching about how women and their man, then read the Bible. How do you respond to that?
I'm not sure I heard you correctly, but Ezekiel 16, and what was the...
Oh, I mean, there are many insult words about women. Oh, and there are many...
Insulting words?
Yeah, insulting words.
Oh, insulting words.
And maybe there are many, some other places.
Right.
Yeah, in the Bible.
I'm not sure exactly about that text, but I imagine that we need to remember that the reporting of Scripture about human activity doesn't always mean the affirmation of Scripture about human activity. So if a biblical judge makes an oath that results in the killing of his daughter, that doesn't necessarily mean that we should be going about doing the same. I'd have to read that text to give an exact answer on that, but that would be a general response. The narrative does not necessarily mean something that is commanded for us. So I think the fact is, before the fall, woman is given great honor by man, and after the fall, even, woman is given great honor, and so she is to be honored.
Another question.
Yeah, Dr. Yarnell, this is Sam Stevens. There was a comment that you made that really stuck out to me, and it was about looking to God first to understand who man is. And would you say that in the evangelical world, many of us have turned towards man first? And I'm thinking more in terms of the application of psychology and these types of things. We're trying to turn towards man's theory about man to understand man and the application of how church ministers to man.
Yes, I think you're right in that critique. I do think, Sam, that, and I don't think this is just a problem with evangelicals, I think it's a human problem. The fact is that our language about God and ourselves is human language. And so we're always going to be wrapped up in approaching things from a human perspective. And this is why we have to constantly have recourse to Scripture and prayer for the illumination of the Spirit in order to radically move our minds away from a carnal, fallen, cultural way of seeing things to a divine, a word-based, a spirit-based way of seeing what we are. And this is a struggle, and this is hard work, and it must constantly be renewed because our minds are capable of constantly twisting Scripture, even our interpretations of Scripture, and then our interpretations of the world in inappropriate ways. But as a basic rule, we ought not go to Freud for our understanding of human relations. We ought to go to Scripture.
Another question for Dr. Yarnell.
My name is Jerry Wing. You mentioned in your lecture a couple of points about the church losing some of its founding or foundation regarding marriage, not so much along the homosexual lines, but in terms of divorce and the permanence of marriage. Do you see any use in using some of the same terms that we have used for homosexual relations, the idea of a man and a man being ineligible for marriage as biblically defined, in broader heterosexual relations than have hitherto been used?
Would you repeat the last part of that again? Because I'm not sure I got the question.
It's very easy to use the term ineligible for marriage regarding a homosexual relationship. But that language is less frequently used regarding divorced persons or something like that. Would it be useful to use that same language in more applications than has hitherto been used?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Jerry. I think that's a very good question, and I think the gist of your question is correct. We do need to be willing to say much more often than we have been that not only is homosexuality wrong with regard to marriage, but an adulterer ought not to be allowed to be married again in the church. Jesus is very explicit about this. A few years ago, I actually had the privilege of meeting the Episcopalian Bishop of New Hampshire. His successor as the Bishop of New Hampshire was the first gay bishop in CUSA, the Episcopal Church of the USA, Vicki Jean Robinson. Gene Robinson broke a standard that the Episcopal Church ended up splitting over. The Diocese of Fort Worth, for instance, the Bishop of the Diocese of Fort Worth once told me that the Episcopal Church of the USA was apostate. That's really strong for an Episcopalian to say. But in my conversation with the previous Bishop of New Hampshire, what he said shocked me because it was true. He said that the decision to compromise marriage with regard to homosexuality was not made at the cusp of the 21st century. It was made at the cusp of the 20th century. When the Episcopal Church began to turn its eye on divorce, that's when the radical decision was made. And for a liberal to be able to say that, and of course now he said it with approval, we ought to be willing to recognize that he's right and then state our disapproval. And the fact is that God hates divorce. And we find people all the time in pastoral situations saying, but my feelings are there, not there anymore, and surely God doesn't want me to suffer. And so, I mean, you may have heard these before. I've heard them. The fact is that God hates divorce, and the church ought to stand and proclaim that same truth. And as far as ineligibility, yes, that not only extends to the homosexual, that extends to the adulterer. And so, yes, I do think that we ought to be willing to use that language much more than we have been. Actually, that if the bishop is right, that's where the line was crossed in the first place, was in heterosexual marriage. We gave up on that. Everything else began to flow in after that. And as Dr. Leno has said, it's going to continue. We're going to see multiple marriages, marriages with animals, all sorts of just sheer wickedness that now wants to call itself in a marriage covenant.
Any other questions for Dr. Yarnell this evening?
In recent years, and kind of going off the last question, we've seen a rise in divorce in the church and in just in the world we live in. Can you say that one of the reasons this rise is coming is because the church or Christians in general have kind of degraded the idea of the Trinity, and that's what led to the separation of divorce? And if that's the case, how would you counteract this trend of Christians and divorce?
Well, that is a very good question. Did your wife give that one to you? Be honest. Okay. Actually, that's a really good question. It is interesting that our surrender of basic community, of understanding ourselves as communal beings, as male and female, did occur in the same period in which the Trinity went into decline. I mean, it occurs in the modern period. So Schleiermacher assigns the Trinity to a doubtful appendix. And at the same time, man begins to see himself primarily in hyper-individualistic fashion. And so, yes, I've not done the research, but there does seem to be some smoke that may indicate a fire in that. I mean, when we do not see ourselves as husband and wife being one flesh, then this also compromises our ability to see the Trinity as both simple and complex God at the same time. It's just outside of our capability. The God we worship ends up becoming who we are in our activity. And so Trinity and humanity and our views of who God is and who man is are inextricably intertwined. So very good question. I think it would take some more research to tease it out and to demonstrate the truthfulness historically of that question, but I think you're actually on to something. You may have your dissertation.
We are now past the 8:30 mark, and Dr. Yarnell, we thank you so much for the generosity with which you have entertained our questions tonight, and thank you so much for the wonderful lecture you delivered this evening. Dr. Yarnell's final lecture will be tomorrow afternoon at 1 p.m. in this room, and we invite all to come and enjoy the conclusion of his lecture series for this year. Would you bow your heads and let me pray for you, please? And so, Father, would you take these people who have invested this evening to learn more about you and your ways and your creation? Would you bless them? Would you keep them safe from the evil one? And by your mercy, would you deliver grace upon grace to them through Jesus Christ? By the Holy Spirit, we ask it so that you will be glorified tonight and forevermore. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
Would you thank me one last time for Dr. Yarnell's